let's start our discussion from where we left in the previous class and we started looking at how to inherit attributes of the stack. And one example we took was of declaration grammar, and we were trying to see that all the rules which are just being used to copy certain attributes on different parts of the tree, whether they could be eliminated by using information on the stack. And these two actions which are initializing certain attributes, and these two actions which are making entries in the symbol table, these are the only ones which are important. And therefore, if I can eliminate the other rules, then I'll actually be able to handle the stack part. And we went through this example of finding out that whenever certain reductions are taking place, that means I have a reduction which says either L goes to L comma ID or L goes to ID. I was able to find value of the type information somewhere on the stack. And using this, then we found that actually this entry, which was corresponding to L going to ID, could be replaced by finding out that the type information is on the stack just below L. And in this case, when I was doing reduction by this tool, which said L going to L comma ID, and I had corresponding action here, I was able to find that value of the type was available at top minus 3. And once I identified this stack, then I was able to eliminate all the copy rules and was straight away able to make these entries. So these two initializations and these two entries, or these two actions for the entries, were the only things I required. Right? This is what we were doing. Okay? And now, let's see what is the property I identified in replacing all those actions of copy by straight away saying that I could find value of this attribute of the stack itself. Right? So you notice something that is there some unique property which I should be looking for so that I can always use this scheme in general? Because the trick is that if I cannot generalize it, then this is not going to work. Okay? So I want to find a general solution so that it will work for all the grammars. So what is the characteristic you notice in this particular grammar so that it becomes now a general scheme? Any ideas? So two things. Okay? Let me once again bring this into focus. So what were the rules, grammar rules, when I was able to replace all these information by stack information? One was that when I had this reduction which said L goes to ID, and another was when I said L goes to L comma ID. Okay? These are the two times I was able to do this replacement. And in this case, as I said, the type was always at top minus 1, and in this case, type information was always at top minus 3, right? So what is unique about it? Is there something unique? So what is unique about this is that doesn't matter when I am doing this reduction. If I do this reduction, there is a predetermined place on the stack where this information is available. Similarly, when I do reduction by this rule, there is a predetermined place on the stack where this information is available. Now, suppose I get into a situation where I do not know what this predetermined place is, then this scheme is going to fail. Right? So let's look at first an example of a grammar like this. Okay? So take this grammar. We have two rules for S. One says S goes to lowercase a, AAC, and this says S goes to B, ABC, and C goes to X. Okay. And it happens that C inherited is a copy of A synthesized. Okay. So inherited attribute of this C is a copy of A synthesized, and corresponding to this rule, I have CS going to, or CS being assigned a function of C inherited. Okay. Now what happens? Can I apply this scheme? Okay. Will the same scheme work? That I say that I don't have to now worry about finding out, because C inherited is nothing but a copy of A synthesized. And therefore, if I need to use this rule, then there is no need to really copy C inherited here. I should be directly using A synthesized. Okay. Is that possible here?
Yes, no.
Why? If you're saying no, then why? If you're saying yes, and again, you have to justify both the cases. So, focus on this particular rule. This is where I am saying that I am using C inherit, which happens to be a copy of A synthesized. So I am saying that instead of making a copy, directly use A synthesized, and A synthesized is already on the stack. Okay. Now, when I am doing this reduction, when I do reduction of X to C, do I know where A synthesized is? Why would I not know? So I know the positions.
Yes, sir.
So will it work?
Can we either of the positions? But then we can check them by because the terminals are starting by A or B. So we can check that.
Terminals starting by A or B.
So
wait a minute. Then we have forgotten about parsing altogether. So if I am doing my parsing, what will be the configuration of stack? So let me assume two configurations of the stack. Okay. So these are only talking about the state stack and not the value stack. My stack configuration will either be A, capital A X before this reduction, or it will be B, capital A, B and X. These are going to be my stack configuration before I do this reduction. Before I say that this C either goes, this X either goes to C or this X either goes to C. And this is the time I say that I want to compute C synthesized, which happens to be a function of C inherited, which happens to be a copy of A synthesized. Okay. That means either the value of A synthesized is here in the corresponding value stack, or corresponding value stack may contain value of A synthesized. Problem is, when I am doing this reduction, okay, I do not know which rule I am going to use next for either this reduction or this. At that point of time, I have no clue. I am talking in general about bottom-up process. Right? So when I do this particular reduction, then it is not clear whether next reduction is going to be by the first rule or the second rule. Okay? And therefore, position of A when this reduction happens is not known. It could be below that top minus 1 or it could be top minus 2. Okay? And that is where the problem is. Now, how do I carry this information so that I can always find it at a fixed place? We talked about the general trick. What was the general trick? So, how did I move my embedded actions to the end? What was the trick I used? Louder, somebody has to say something. Addition of external terminals, and I call these markers. Okay. Now suppose I use a similar trick here and change my rule to something like this. If I say S goes to A, A, C, and then I say S goes to B, A, B, C, and then I say C goes to X. Now, instead of this, okay, I am now making a small change and saying that let me put a marker M here and then I say M goes to X. Okay. Now, what happens? Now, what I can do is that now you can see that if A synthesized is just below it, and now in this I make a copy of A synthesized, then doesn't matter. Whenever I do reduction by this rule, A synthesized is just going to be below this. Right? Can I use this trick? Not sinking. So now suppose my stack configuration in this case becomes, when I'm changing my second rule, my stack configuration will be something like this. B, A, B, M, and X. And now, this marker is used to keep a copy of A synthesized. Okay? Now suppose I make a copy of A synthesized here, I make a copy of A synthesized here, then is there a difference between this reduction and this reduction as far as reduction by this rule is concerned? It's always below it, right? It's always at top minus. So what I can do when I'm leading you towards the general solution, that in the first case, why this scheme worked? Because whenever I did a reduction, I was always able to find a predetermined location for my synthesized attribute. If I make similar transformation in my grammar, and you can see that this transformation is not going to change the language I'm trying to parse. Okay? And therefore, if I now make this change, okay? So problem is that it is either a top minus one or top minus two, which I do not know. So now if I make this change and say that I am introducing a marker, and when I introduce a marker, I also have to introduce certain rules. And the rules here are that M inherited is now a copy of A synthesized, and then I say C synthesized is nothing but a copy of M synthesized. And then when I do this particular reduction with epsilon, I'm saying that synthesized attribute will be nothing but a copy of inherited attribute. And then I can always say that C synthesized is a function of C inherited. Now I know that when I'm talking of C inherited, which is a copy of A synthesized, this MS is also, you can see, is a copy of M synthesized, A synthesized, right, through this rule. So A synthesized is copied into MI, MI is copied into MS, okay? And MS is used just here, which is just below it, and I'm done. So in this case, I will have AS here, in this case, I'll have AS here. So I'll not have to worry about which rule I'm going to use for reduction next. I'll always say that whenever you reduce by this rule, which says C goes to X, always find the attribute just below it. Make sense? Okay. That still has a limitation. So now whenever we apply this production, I can always find that M synthesized is nothing but a copy of A synthesized, and therefore value of C inherited, which is nothing but a copy of M A synthesized, is always a top minus one. I don't have to worry about it. But there's still a limitation. And what is that limitation? And how do I crack that problem? I've still not solved it. Because as I said, I'm leading you towards a general solution, but I have still not reached all the way. There's still a limitation I have. And what is that? So when did this scheme fail? So first problem I started with was, I'm saying that I will always have attributes at a predetermined location, and the assumption I made was that most of the time attributes are nothing but copies of one another. Okay. Will the scheme fail if it is not a copy of just another attribute? So what happens now? If I say that CI is a copy of AS and MI is a copy of AS, suppose CI is not a copy of AS. CI is a function of AS. It needs to be evaluated. Then where will I find it? So let's look at this one. Okay. Now, when I say this is not a copy and this is a function, then I need to evaluate it. And again, I'm going to use the same general trick, and I'll say that I'm going to put another marker, and this marker is the place where it will hold the value of the attribute, but after evaluating it. Okay. Now, this gives me the most general case, where I say that doesn't matter whether your attribute is a copy or attribute is a function of another attribute, I can always pre-evaluate and keep it on the stack in the predetermined position. Okay? Now with this, I have all these tools, I have now enough machinery available to me where I can generalize my algorithm. Okay? So now let's move towards generalization of algorithm. And what, at this point of time, I'm going to propose is that let's say that I have, in general, a rule which says A goes to x1, x2, to xn, okay? And I can have attributes which are copies, I can have attributes which are not copies but which are functions, and I want to generalize. Okay? So what I can do now is, corresponding to every symbol on the right-hand side, I can blindly introduce a marker. And if I introduce a marker, then what will happen? My grammar will become something like this. only one change I'll do, and then I'll say that all these m's, so m1 goes to epsilon, m2 goes to epsilon, up to all mk is going to epsilon. And what do these markers hold now? What they can hold now is, remember that, now go back, and I was talking about evaluation order. And if you remember what was evaluation order, we said that inherited attribute of a symbol must be evaluated in the position which is immediately left to it. Okay? And that means I can now say that M1 actually contains X1i and MK contains XKi. So all marker symbols are going to contain the inherited attribute and all the symbols themselves on the value stack, obviously, and all the symbols, grammar symbols on the value stack, they are going to contain the synthesized attribute. Okay? So now I can say that corresponding to this location, X1 synthesized, corresponding to this location, I have X2 synthesized, and corresponding to this location, I have XK synthesized. So now you can see on the value stack, all the inherited attributes can be there, and all the synthesized attributes can be there. Right? And depending upon whether this is a copy or this is a function, I'm going to have the appropriate rule on the right hand side. So if it is just a copy, then I copy it from the predetermined location, and if it is a function, then I just put a function at the end. Now do I have a predetermined location for everything? So suppose now I'm saying that a reduction happens to, let's say, MK. Now when I say reduction happens to MK, what is the attribute I want to compute? I'm computing MK inherited attribute, which basically is XK inherited. Okay? To compute XK inherited and place here, what do I need to know? I need to know all these attributes and inherited attribute of A, right, in my L attributed definitions. Now where will be the inherited attribute of A on the stack? Where will I find inherited attribute of A on the stack? Will I have a predetermined location for that? So A will occur somewhere on the right hand side in the production. Corresponding to that, there will be a marker. Right? So inherited attribute of A will be in that location. So if I start now showing you the stack, this is how the stack will look. Okay? That I will have corresponding to, let's say, marker of A, which will contain value of A inherited, and then I will have M1, X1, up to MK. And XK. Now suppose I am doing a reduction to this, XK has not yet come in, I am doing this reduction and I am computing inherited attribute of XK, that is going to be computed here and I can now find everything it depends upon on the stack. These are all predetermined pre-computed positions. And if I want to, if reduction is taking place to, let's say, XK, which is synthesized attribute, okay, then what does it depend upon? When this reduction happens, then all the attributes of the right hand side corresponding to this rule which said xk is on the right hand side must have been on the stack. So before I pushed xk, I'm going to then compute the synthesized attribute, pop all those symbols and push xk and push the synthesized attribute of xk on the value stack. That is my general scheme. Okay? But this general scheme seems to be slightly flawed. I'm using just too much space, right? So how can I reduce space? How can I optimize this?
Markers are not required
every day. Very good. So if markers are not required, then what do I do? So if a grammar symbol does not have inherited attribute, then I don't need a marker. So I can throw away some of the markers. I will only keep markers for the inherited attributes. Now that still, because I know which markers I am throwing away, okay, that only needs recomputation of the offsets. But they will always be the predetermined locations. Right? So I can reduce number of markers by saying that for certain inherited attributes I will not require, or for certain symbols I don't have inherited attributes and therefore I will not require it, and then I can throw it. So in general, what I can do is, that if I am using the bottom up parser and a translation with inherited attributes, my input are L attributed definitions, and what I want is a bottom up parser. So what I do is, for every noun terminal which has one inherited attribute and every grammar symbol has a synthesized attribute, and for every production of this form which says A goes to x1 to xn, I'm going to introduce markers m1 to mn, and I'm going to replace this production by a production which has markers, and then all m1 to mn can go to xi. Okay. And then synthesized attribute of x1 s is going to go into the entry value stack corresponding to x1, and inherited attribute of x1 is going to go into the marker corresponding to x. Okay. That gives me the predetermined location. So if reduction is to a marker, then marker belongs to this particular production, then what do? AI is in this position, which is top minus 2A plus 2. Okay. This is, I'm computing from this particular stack, and x1i is in a position which is above it, and so on. Okay. And if reduction is to non-terminal A by this production, then what do? Compute AS and push it from the stack. Okay. So this is the most general scheme I have for finding out all attributed or L attributed definitions on the stack itself. Of course, I am assuming here that every grammar symbol will have only one inherited attribute. If it has more inherited attributes, you will have to put more markers. Basically, what we are doing is we are creating space on the stack. Okay, so the scheme can be easily generalized. Okay. Here, any questions on this? Okay, so let's continue our discussion on the optimization. Okay. Now, I need to worry about keeping all these attributes somewhere. I need to allocate certain space for this. Okay. So one space I have created, all these are markers, and I'm saying that it's not good enough to say that keep a marker for every symbol, and therefore use markers only for the symbols which require an inherited attribute and put them on the value side. Can I do better than that? Because now we are really worried about the implementation. We really want to have a compiler which is fast, we want to have algorithms which are fast. Can I further reduce? Say something, think something, make a suggestion.
All markers which hold the same value can be reduced to just one.
Okay, so how do I do that? So, proposal is that all markers which hold the same value, they can be reduced to a single location. Good. Can I do better than that? So let me give you a program instance. Okay? Now suppose I have a program just 3 lines, nothing else. How many variables do I have? So I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. Right? So when I do memory allocation, I'm going to say that I'm going to allocate 7 locations for this. Okay. Do I really need 7 locations? So what happens here is, I'm saying that A is being assigned B plus C. Now, there are some locations which are associated with B and C, but you can see that beyond this point, I am not using B and C. So, can I just say that, let me overwrite one of those locations and use that for A? Can I do that? Okay. Similarly, when I say now that P is in a location, so can I say that I can use for A location for B, and then for P I can use location of C because that was not required. And then I say that beyond this point, neither P nor A are required, so X takes one of those locations, and then the location which was freed by used by Z, and then X was already in that location and that is assigned to Y. So do I need 7 or I can do with fewer? Can you use just 2 or 3? So what is the trick I am using here? So the trick I am using here is that I am looking at lifetime of each variable. I am seeing that lifetime of a variable starts from the time this is initialized till the time it is last used. And beyond this, I don't have to block a space for this. I can free this. Right? And the same trick I am going to use here, there is no reason that there are attributes which are copies of each other and these attributes beyond a point. See, attribute equations are something similar to this. Right? So if I don't require this attribute beyond a point for computation, why should I just keep it on the stack and keep blocking all this information on the stack? I can as well use registers. I can use some other locations which are not even related to the stack and say that my attributes are going to be there. Okay? So if I say that I want to do lifetime computation, so lifetime begins when it is first computed and lifetime of an attribute ends when all the attributes which depend upon it have been computed. Okay? And as soon as that happens, I just release that location. So for example, in this case, lifetime of B and C ends as soon as this statement is computed, because beyond this point, B and C have no use. So I can use the same location. Okay? So space can be conserved by assigning space for an attribute only during its lifetime. And I don't keep locking that space for whole of the program. Okay? So if I just do this computation, okay, let's look at the grammar which is slightly similar to what we have done. Don't worry about this grammar. Okay? That's not the important part. Okay? But I am going to show you attribute computation for this grammar and I will first show you the dependence graph. Okay? So what we want to do is, here I am again initializing all my identifiers, I have type information, but I have also introduced now saying that I can have arrays. This is just to make it a little more complex, okay? Nothing more tricky than that. Okay? But important part is that if I now try to parse in x3, x5, y5 and I look at first the abstract syntax tree for this, and then I introduce all the dependencies. This is how dependency is going to be that. One is going to be used for computation of 2, and then 3 and 6 are going to use what was computed here, and 7 is going to use 6, and so on. Okay? So this is how the computation is going to happen. Okay? Now let's see what is the lifetime of these variables, and how do I optimize my number of locations which I can use. So let me just put these computations. I am doing computations from 1 to 9. So I have this computation 1, 2, 3. Let me draw it vertically so that we have more space. So these are the 9 computations I am doing. Okay? And looking at the dependence graph here, we say that 2 uses what was computed in 1, and then 6 and 3 use what was computed in 2, and 7 uses what was computed in 6, and then 9 uses what was computed in 7 and 8, and on the other side of the tree, 5 uses what was computed in 3 and 4. Right? I'm just taking all these red arrows and flattening this graph. This is how the computation will be. Now you can see that as far as this is concerned, okay, now let me start allocating resources to this. So I say that the first I compute 1 and therefore I allocate resource R1 to this. Okay? And then I compute 2, but now beyond this point 1 has no use. Okay? And therefore I can now use the same resource here. Okay? I am preserving immediately, you can see that I am preserving one location. Then I say that I want to now compute 3. 3 depends upon 2, but 2 has a future use. 2 is going to be used here, and therefore I allocate a new resource to this, and I say that this is R2. Okay? Then I say that I want to compute now 4. Okay? But I can see that 4, before 4 can be given a space, I cannot free this space and I cannot free this space. they have a future use. So I now say that I'm going to use an R3 here. Okay. And now when I come to this node and say I want to do computation, then I find that beyond this point, both R2 and R3 have no use. Okay. And therefore, I can treat both these locations and I can say that this goes into resource R2. Okay. And then I come to this node and now I find that this node depends only on this. Okay. And now I can free even R1. Okay. And therefore, I can allocate R1 to resource number 6. Okay. And when I come to 7, then I find that 7 depends on 6, which is bound to resource R1. So I can then just compute, put this information in R1. And then I find that R2 beyond this point had no use. Finally, computation was done. So when it comes to R8, I can use R2 here. And when it comes to 9, I can free both R1 and R2 and put that information in R1. So rather than having a large stack where I was putting all these grammar symbols, I can actually do it just 3 resources. That's an optimization. Right. Now can I do better than this? Because remember that we are trying to extract every possible information. Look for everything. All the information is in this graph. There's nothing else. So let's go back, okay, in this. So what happens here? When you say L inherited is T type is real, T type is integer, L1 inherited is L inherited, I inherited is L inherited, I inherited is L inherited, and so on, okay? If you see, all these are nothing but copies, okay? Only computation that is happening is either here or here. Rest, I'm just creating copies. Now, if I just are creating copies. Now you can see that actually 2 is nothing but, if I say this is my resource R1, 2 is nothing but R1. The same copy. Okay? This is what I did. If you go back, okay, this is what I'm saying. L inherited is T type. I just created another copy. Okay? If I'm creating another copy, okay, then I don't even have to worry about lifetime. So first find out what are the copies which I'm creating. Okay? So I created copies here. Then 3 and 6 also happen to be copies of R1. 3 and 6, they are also copies of R1, okay? And what about 7? 7 also happens to be a copy of R1. So if I use this information, okay, only computation that is happening is at 5 and 9. And now how many additional resources do I need? Just one more, right? I first compute 5, put that information in the symbol table and corresponding to 9. I do this computation and I can actually work with just 2 resources, sufficient. So I don't have to maintain that large value stack. I can use some other locations. I just need to keep track of this information. Okay. So using all possibilities like lifetime information, finding out what are the copy rules and therefore binding a resource with it. And remember that all this trick is going to be used for register allocation. When I finally start generating machine code, you will find that I have limited number of registers. Most machines will provide you 8 or 16 registers. Okay? And I will try to see that whenever I do an expression evaluation or any evaluation, I try to use registers as far as possible. So I try to free registers as early as possible whenever there is no future use. And if it is keeping the same value, I will try to reuse the register. So I'm going to use the same trick here and say that if I look at resource requirement, this is how my graph looks. Okay? And if I allocate resources using lifetime information, this is how the information is going to be bound. And finally, I'm using only 3 locations. And I'm using allocate. I'm trying to now using information like copy information. And suddenly, I find that many of these are copies. And if they are copies, then I just need 2 resources. So whatever information is available to you, try to use that information to further optimize it. So now you can see that not only we understand algorithm, we understand where the attributes are available, but we can also further optimize it and see that I can now work with just 2 resources, which happens to be in this case, but the techniques are general, where you say that whatever are copies, you bind certain variables to it, and then you use lifetime information and try to minimize all this, all the number of resources by using this additional. Right? So thumb rules are that you will just look at copies and you will look at lifetime. And once we apply this thumb rule, then we'll be able to further optimize your program. Of course, number of resources will depend upon the kind of program you're trying to optimize. So for different grammar rules, you will have different number of resources. So copy information is right here, right? You see that if you go back to this grammar here, so let me go back to this grammar, okay? Or I can go back to this grammar, okay? This is, suppose I bound a resource to T type, okay? Now you can see that when I'm talking of L inherited, I'm making a copy, okay? So I can say that, look, lifetime of T type is not just ending here, but it is going beyond this because I have a copy here. And similarly, if I look at L inherited is being copied here. Okay? So I can say this is basically the same resource. I don't have to reallocate it. So by finding out copy information, I'm slightly extending my lifetime information. Okay? So this is what happens here. If you want to look at the graph, we are saying that 2 is a copy of 1, and 6 and 3 are also copies of 2. And 7 is a copy of 6, and 5 happens to be a copy of 5, will depend upon this. But so you can see 1, 2, 3, and 4, these are nothing but copies. Okay. And this is where I use this information that I say that 1 is, and then 2, 3, 6, and 7 are nothing but just copies. So they are same things, 1. So that means I can say that whatever was allocated here is being used here, and therefore don't free R1 till this point. Once I recognize this fact, then you will find that what I was doing here, I was saying that I am going to use this resource and then use R2, but this is nothing but a copy, right? So I don't have to allocate a new resource for this because R1 is already there. And then I say that as far as this node is concerned, compute that in R2, but lifetime of R2 hence here because 5 is depending upon 3 and 4. And therefore it's not really a copy, it requires. So whenever you have 2 inputs, you require a not copy, you need a new resource. Whenever it's just copy of another, then I can just use a copy rule there. Okay? So that means 5 will depend upon 3 and 4, and 3 has a further use, which is R1, but 4 can be freed here, and therefore 5 can go into R. Similarly, now once this part is done, then I say 8 is now a new resource required, but 9, now both R1 and R2 can be freed because beyond this point even R1 has no use, so I just use R1. Right, so when you are constructing your compiler, you need to worry about space. Okay? So, I mean, I'll tell you, I think I told you this story somewhere in the beginning where people were not careful while building compilers. So, I mean, we went through a personal experience where we were trying to make a compiler and programs were written in a certain manner. And we found suddenly that the compilation became so slow that you give a small program for compilation and just not coming out. It's not coming out of compilation cycle. And the reason was that symbol table became so large that all the time there was not sufficient memory and it was doing this swap. I mean, it tried to put some symbol table in the memory and it found there was not enough space. Those days I'm talking of somewhere around 88, 89. So machines did not have this kind of memory. Where you said, my virtual space is 4 GB, I have 32 bit addressability, and therefore I have physical memory of 4 GB, now I mean you have 16 GB, 32 GB. We're talking about 1 MB kind of that. Okay, 1 MB was even considered. And then suddenly you found you had a symbol table which will not put in, fit into memory. And all the time space was being wasted in stuff. Okay? So on a program, you want to compile a function which is like 5-line function and it takes 3 hours to compile. Okay? Because people were not careful in building their symbol table properly. Okay? And once you go through this optimization, then you found that it was a matter of milliseconds. Okay? Because remember that when it comes to overheads, it's not just in terms of saying that your symbol table can be very big, and instead of our linear symbol table, start using hashing and so on. You still have to reduce the size, because if it does not fit into main memory, then you're going to, operating system is going to waste a lot of time in stack. Okay. So you have to be aware of this fact, that ultimately compiler is going to run, or any system software is going to run under control of operating system. And if you are not careful in space optimization, so this, many of the people have this notion saying, oh, don't worry about space, there's a lot of memory available. There's never enough memory on the system. You can always write programs which can crash your system. So one has to be very, very careful, and one has to learn all possible techniques to reduce amount of memory. memory is and resources are always at a peak. So this is one optimization. But I want to further optimize. So what other optimizations I can think of? So let me go back to one of the examples we dealt with earlier. So we had this example which said S goes to block, and then we had this block going to B1 or B2, and then we had another block going to B1 subscript B2 and so on. Remember this grammar? What was this? Equation type 7. Right? Now, when I start looking at information here, okay, what happens is that attribute can be held on a single stack. Okay? So what is it that we were doing? That when this reduction was taking place, basically what was happening was that I had this B1 on the stack, and then I had B2 on the stack, and now suppose I have to put markers on the stack, then I also need space for inherited attributes. Now when I say space for inherited attributes, that means immediately my stack changed to something like this. Okay? I must have had a marker for B1, then I had B1, then I had a marker for B2, and then I had B2. My actually stack was of size 4, right? And these markers were keeping the inherited attributes. So this is where, what was the inherited attribute in this example? Point size. And what was the synthesized attribute? Height, right? So I was keeping now point size here. And I was keeping of B1 height here. Now you can see that actually these are nothing but copies, right? So one way, I just showed you that I'm going to use registers, I'm going to use certain resources, I don't want to use stacks, okay? But sometimes you may not be able to avoid stacks, okay? But can I split this now? Now what is the, so when I say that I'm going to do a reduction by this rule of this form, okay? What is the maximum size of the stack possible? Potentially what height can it grow? So when I say that I am doing reduction by this rule, let's say, forget about any other symbol. Okay? What can be the maximum height of the stack here? 4, right? So in general, if you have k symbols on the right hand side, you can height of the stack can be up to 2k. Right? But you find that within this 2k, okay, you have these copies. Okay? Now suppose I separate my inherited attribute stack and synthesized attribute stack. Okay? Then what will happen? I'll have two stacks of height 2. But as soon as I do this separation, I'll say, oh, but this stack, the top and top minus 1 have the same value. So I can keep it in the same location and keep it height 1. So I will save one space there in general. Okay? So in general, what we can do is that whenever I have a rule which is of this form, which says A goes to BC, okay, stack goes up to height of 5. Okay? So how will stack go up to height of 5? Because I'll have inherited attribute of A. Then I have inherited and synthesized attributes of B and C on the stack. So totally it can become 5 before top 4 symbols are pushed out and A synthesized comes on the stack. And that will reduce to 2 once again. Okay? So just before reduction, this is how my stack will look. Inherited attribute of A, then inherited attribute of B, synthesized attribute of B, inherited of C and synthesized of C. And immediately after reduction, my stack will have inherited attribute of A and synthesized attribute. And if I show you pictorially the example which I just picked up, this is how your tree will be constructed and how will my stack look. So when I'm saying that I'm at this node, I'm only left hand side will be synthesized attributes. So I'll say that B point size is on this stack. Then I'll say B point size and B1 point size will be on the stack. And in this, I will compute synthesized attribute, okay, which is going to be here, computed. And then I'll put B2 point size, and as soon as I evaluate B2, I will also have B2 height on the stack, so it grows to height 5, and then it again reduces to a height of 2. Right? This is how you have to see that stack started here, then kept on growing till it came back to a height of 2. Now, I don't want my stack to grow to this height, and you will find that many times B point size, B1 point size, B2 point size, these are nothing but the same values. Okay? So what I do is, I separate the stacks. I say that instead of having two stacks, one for inherited attribute, another for synthesized attribute, I have only not one but two stacks. One for inherited, another for synthesized. And if I do that, then what will happen is that I'll say B point size is here, but B synthesized is still empty. And now I say, now this is where the trick starts coming. Using the copy rules, I say, oh, I know for sure that B1 point size is nothing but B point size. So I don't have to push that value. That is already on the top of stack, right? And then I'm going to say that I only need to compute B1 height here. B1 point size is already on the top of stack. And again, I find B2 point size is nothing but a copy rule, and it is on the top of stack. And only my synthesized attribute goes to a height 2, which will have both synthesized attribute of B1 and synthesized attribute of B2. And then, finally, this reduction happens, and my synthesized attribute again comes to height 1. So now you can see that my inherited attribute stack did not grow beyond 1, remained only at height 1, because of all these copies. Okay? And my synthesized attribute starting from empty, it grew to a height 2 and finally reduced to height 1. Okay, so you can see that if I separate it, okay, my total number of, again, spaces are going to go down. Now, I mean, this, in percentage-wise, this may look, I mean, absolute numbers may not look very large. Percentage-wise, you can do this computation, but real benefit will come when you find that suddenly on the right-hand side you have a large production. Then separating the synthesized and inherited, inherited and synthesized attributes is going to be your benefit.
Yeah. How do you prepare the stack position? Like in this example, if it goes to M1, X1, M2, X2, 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 and M4, X2, and M4 requires the attribute of M1, and M2 is your state, then how do you use that position of stack?
You have already answered your question. Okay. Because these are our predetermined locations. Look at it this way. So suppose I say that this attribute does not exist, right? And I want to find out where is, now I'm saying that I want to find out who compute MK, okay? I need all these attributes and M2 does not exist. Then what will happen to these heights? Only offset will change by one, but I know that at the time of construction of the grammar. So I can recompute all these offsets. So it's not that I'm doing something later. I'm saying I'm constructing my grammar. I'm saying certain grammar symbols, certain markers do not exist. So I can find out all the locations. Same thing I'll do here. I say these are copy rules. Okay. Now you can see that actually this is very close to what I did earlier in terms of resources. Because I'm saying that synthesized attribute is just one resource. I'm just binding one to it, one resource to it. And therefore I can always say that not really doesn't matter whether I use some other resource or I use a stack. Because here I have bound a stack which is of height 1. I could have said that point size is bound to a certain resource, which is resource 1, and I am using only resource 1 here all the time. So that advantage will come by separating the two stacks. Right? So, take away from all this exercise is that if you just want to see the principles here, remember two things. One, that there are going to be certain attributes which are just copies of each other, and therefore you should preserve that information, what is copy of each other. And second, that each attribute is going to have certain lifetime and allocate resources only for the duration of lifetime and not otherwise. Okay. If you just remember these two rules, then suddenly you will find that your total space requirement is going to go down drastically. And these are really the tricks which are used in the square root. And we are doing the same thing in resource allocation. So, I mean, I don't want to distinguish between registers and resources. So these are nothing but, as far as we are concerned, these are just resources and we want to optimize all the possible resources. And this optimization is the one which is going to make your programs much faster. Because suddenly you find you have some additional bookkeeping to be done, because now you want to manipulate all the stack positions and you must remember in where the predetermined locations are. But once you have done that, that's one time exercise. Once you have done that, then suddenly you find that your compiler is going to be much faster. And don't think that, I mean, you don't have to worry about compile time. It's only one time activity. and only the execution time is important. This has an impact on execution time also. Okay, because if you use too many resources, suppose I do not optimize my code, I just use large number of registers, what will happen? I'll have to do register scaling somewhere. Register scaling means extra machine cycles. And if you have more instructions, that means extra fetch cycles. So a good compiler is going to make sure that we generate optimized code. But at the same time, remember, compiler is also a program. So the compiler itself needs to be optimized. Any questions? Okay. So let's break here today, and tomorrow we are going to start our discussion on type systems and see that how to compute all the type expressions and build up a type system for the language. Okay. So let's break here and continue our discussion tomorrow.